Okay, the time is up. Let's start our talk. Thanks everyone here for coming this session. My name is Ian Bo Liang, and I'm an Apache Spark committer and software engineer at Hortonworks. And my ordinary work focuses on machine learning and data science. So in this talk, I will share some thoughts and experience on how to use Spark and Zeppelin for text mining on very large data size. And we also show some features in we just released HTTP 2.6 to facilitate the text mining workload. In this talk, I suppose that the audience have a basic understanding of Spark and at least to know what Zeppelin is, since I will not give very, very detailed introduction about Spark and Zeppelin. And mainly focus on how to use this in the right place to solve the text mining problems. Okay, this is the agenda. We will first start with talk about the challenge of text mining when it encounter big data. And then we talk about how Spark and especially the Spark machine learning library, ML Lab, and how easy and effectively it is to solve the machine learn the text mining problems by create a very typical pipeline. The pipeline can used and shared by you and other data scientists or software engineers. At last, we will give a very short talk about Zeppelin and show how Zeppelin can accelerate the whole process. Okay, as we all know, text mining is a very, very old topic and very, very widely used. It's a process to knowledge discovery from unstructured data sets. In many industry areas, it has very important roles, such as we can classification the email is spam or not. We can detect the fraud or not is in, used in financial or other areas. And the text cluster by topics is also widely used. We usually use the LDA algorithms. We will talk later. And another important use case is sentiment analysis to identify what your customers are saying about your company and your product in the social medias, since customers will express their ideas mostly in text. And another use case is recommendations or advertisements based on the context. Automatic labeling is also important for the news summaries. So these are the use case of text mining. And in the old days, in traditional way, we can solve these problems very elegantly, since they usually load data from the database system such as Oracle, and then we buy some commercial software to run text mining jobs on a single machine. This is really, really very easy for the data is not it's not big, and since we can use a software and on a single machine to handle all this workflow, and it's easy. With one person, we can do that. And the disadvantage is the software is also very expensive. Some open source software such as GSIM or NRTK or some R packages can do the solve the same problems in a very similar way, but they are not very. You don't need to pay any money for the open source software. And the famous Python library, machine learning library, Scikit-learn, also have some functions to handle the similar workload. But these situations may be different when we encounter big data. You can say, as the increasing of social media data, we can assume that the Twitter stream is increasing big, and the sensor data collected from machine-generated data and CRM information. The data is flooded into every business. In many applications, more data means more better result to your problems. So mining on large scale unstructured data is very, very difficult in traditional way, since most of the traditional algorithms are invented to solve task mining in a single machine. They can't scale very well. It will take you for a long time to solve a single, very, very simple classification problems. And we are very fortunately, the development and the improvement in big data infrastructure are promising. And the analysis capabilities is also increasing, especially the emerging of Spark and Hadoop. Spark is a distributed framework which can handle SQL queries, data frame operations, and some basic machine learning on, and streaming queries on it. Spark gives the ability to process very, very large data in with very simple API. Spark has provided four languages, APIs, Scala, Java, Python, and R. And the large-scale data set is also is not stored, it's configured into a disk of one machine. It may be stored different kinds of storage systems, such as maybe some data stored in HDFS, or some data may be stored in S3, and another very important data may be stored on some database system, such as MySQL or Oracle. So this is the completely big data environment lead us to make an innovation ideas to do pipeline on the to do task mining on the large scale data set. And another important changes is the roles in task mining. Since the problems is more and more complex and the data is bigger and bigger, one person can't to handle all of the problems. We need the data scientist, and we also need software. We need them to work together to solve the problems. And the data scientist usually explore data and to find the best model and parameters. After that, if we have the best parameters and the best model, the software engineer will deploy the model and make prediction based on the new input. The new input is also have possible to very, very big. So the prediction of scoring algorithms and is also need to be distributed. And we also support to prediction our model on the streaming data set. This is useful since some of the scenarios such as anti-fraud, when users generate a new action record, we can give the response in a second. So this we can prevent the anti-fraud. We can give the anti-fraud result, and we can prevent the user's money or user's information. No worry. I think all of these requirements, we can use Spark to handle them. OK, let's step by step to discuss why Spark can handle it. Spark ML Lab is the machine learning library of Spark. It contains some machine learning algorithms based, some are used for the task mining, and I think the task mining related algorithms are almost half of the total algorithms. What's important is these algorithms can scale out as the data growing. For example, if you got big data or bigger input, you can work on it just to get a slightly big cluster. It means that when you can't handle your problems, you just add new machines to the system. Or you have a really big problems which takes a long time currently. Maybe you can scale up your cluster and it can run fast and save your training time. Another situation is Tasmania is usually very, very complex, like we said. It involves several steps and the cooperation with data scientists and software engineer. And MLLab provides the utilities to construct complex workflow pipelines. And it can also import or export the pipeline or the model across in languages and clusters. We will show how it powers the application later. And with the data frame API of the Spark, it has a very important feature, external data source. It can load and write data with lots of formats, such as PyQuery, JSON, or CSV, or AVL. This can make us to ingest all kinds of data from different storage systems. And another very important feature is cross-validation. Cross-validation can help us to reduce the overfitting, which is very, very helpful features for machine learning engineers or for data scientists. OK, I will illustrate how was this happened. Let's start the workflow of a data scientist, and then we talk about software engineer. Currently, you can't say how software should do what, and you will say that later. Data scientists will start to create a text mining pipeline with their preferred Python or R languages. Since data scientists may be not very familiar with Java or Scala, so they can use Python or R to do the model exploration. And then the pipeline also involves several steps and maybe very, very complex. The first step is ingest the data from different storage systems, such as HDFS or HBase or Cloud S3. Now, load the data is extremely easy, since we just talked about data frame has an external data source support, can load and read and save data from different data sources. With the loaded data, data scientists will extract the features, transform features, and select key features, and fit model, evaluate the model, and get best model fit finally. This is a very, very common pipeline for most of the machine learning problems. So for Tasmania, it's also the same. OK, let's give a simple look at the examples with a picture. And let's look at the original data size. It has two columns. The first column is test, and the second is a label. If you think of the data size sort of floating through this workflow, this is not a TensorFlow. We're floating the data frame. What we want to do each time is read from some columns. Say for the feature engineering steps, we will read the text columns and open the new columns. Say we will want to first tokenize the word into a set of words, the original text into a set of words, and hash these words into feature vectors. And the feature vectors often are vectors with double type, and so forth. And after that, for the model training, maybe we'll read from the feature columns and the label columns. With the feature column and label column, we can train a model, especially for the classification model, and spill out the prediction value columns and the probability of prediction. We will have some extra columns for some special algorithms, such as the raw prediction. This is also very important in some case. But this is the normal case. And then for the model evaluation, we want to read from the labels on the prediction columns. Or in some case, we may read from the label columns and the probability columns to calculate some metrics to measure what is the best model, whether this is the best model. The metrics usually cause such as precision or recall in a binary classification problems. So this is a very, very simple workflow or pipeline in Spark, and MLLab can provide us. So what ML provide us was sort of this unified API, where different flow, it has talk, not tensor flow, different flow through a machine learning pipeline. And you just add and remove columns under the control of each pipeline stages. And in the last example, just show we didn't remove any columns, but actually we can do that. Since the data frame of the Spark is lazy computing, so we cannot remove it. We can just, when we use it, we select which columns, that columns will be materialized, and other columns will not touch. So we don't need to remove any columns. And here I list some key abstractions of the Spark ML pipelines. Each stage of the pipeline is one of these components. The first one is transformer. Transformer usually is such as feature transformer, like a hashing TF. We calculate the hashing TF value of each word. And another kind of transformer is the trained models, such as we get the naive base model or the logistic regression model. We can use a model to use the first input data frame to get the prediction value. It's another data frame. And the second kind of components is estimator. All the estimators are ML algorithms, such as naive Bayes logistic regression. And the third component is evaluator. Evaluator will use to evaluate predictions and compute metrics. The metrics, just we talk about precision or recall, is used to tuning the algorithms. So with the three kinds of components, we can construct a pipeline. And for the text mining problems, Spark MLLab provides some very, very basic but very, very important components of the pipeline for us to use. As we all know, MLLab is not a very is a scalable machine learning algorithms and not specified for text mining, but it provides this use for us. So we can use this in our basically ordinary text mining jobs and with not extra third-party libraries. And the first is very important, LDA models for topic model. And Word2Vec is also a popular model, and it's an unsupervised way to turn words into features based on their meanings. And counter-vectorizer and hashing TF also calculate the also convert the words into double type of features, but there are little difference. Counter-vectorizer turns documents into vector based on the word count, but hashing TF uses a different way. It's used to calculate the hash value. And the ADF is also important to calculate the words of the important words with respect to the corpus and much more. This are components which help us to build a text mining pipelines. And let's look at some basic workload and how to use MLLab to help us. This is a very, very common use case. And let's look at what they can do. The pipeline is used to text classification. It's maybe the first text mining workload you encountered, such as anti-fraud, just talk. Let's analyze the workflow. First, we need to process the raw text. The raw text is usually a line of string, and convert it into an array of words. We have provided the regress tokenizer. This is the transformer. And then The next step, we often involve a remaining stopover. We have provided a stopover remover, it's another transformer. And then we can use counter vectorizer or hashing TF. There is a little difference we just talk. After that, we can combine the output to an IDF. The IDF is used to count the IDF value to with respect to the whole corpus. And then we convert the distinct string label to indexed values with numeric type, usually with double type. And then the classification algorithms can recognize it, since string index is used to convert the label to a double type of labels, which can be used. As the last is a classification algorithms. We have provided a lot of classification algorithms. These are the four most frequently used. So this is the basic text classification pipeline. And another one is, yes, it's also very important, is topic model or text cluster. Since we have a lot of documents, we may we may count to extract topics by the by users or by manual humans. So this slide shows the pipeline to infer topics from a collection of unstructured data. Compared with the previous slides, we don't need to handle the label columns since cluster or topic model is unsupervised machine learning. Another scenario is Word2Vec. Word2Vec can do a lot of things, such as recommendation, or you can find simulated items, or we can also use it to do some basic classification or basic classifier, clustering. So Word2Vec is used to produce word embedding, leveraging the two-layer neural networks. This is also very popular, since deep learning is widely talked, but maybe not widely used. And the Word2Vec is the only most popular used deep learning algorithms currently. Okay, summarize the previous three slides. We can give an very overview of what Spark ML Lab can do for text mining. These transformers or these estimators, we don't need to involve any extra third-party libraries. It's built-in algorithms for Spark ML Lab. If you encounter text mining problems on a large large-scale data set, you can figure out the basic pipeline by referring this slide. We have a demo, but due to the time is limited, so we will not show the demo. You can refer this URL to get the demo. The demo is more or less a translation of the scheduler example in its tutorial. Why we put the demo here is to illustrate how to use Spark ML Lab to do very similar works. Like scheduler, but on a very large data set. Okay, also the latest MLLab 2.1 includes more than 30 feature transformers and more than 25 models, and some model tuning and evaluation algorithms, but we still not coverage all text mining algorithms. And the goal of MLLab is not an impossible to have every single algorithms in the world in it. But the key features is we can provide an extensible API so that people can write their algorithms and put it into the whole pipeline. So MLLab provides options to customization. Users need to exchange of the basic operations such as transformer, estimator, and evaluator to implement their own algorithms. So actually, we have some basic existing examples for this extension. You can directly use these examples. The first one is Spark CoNLP. It represents the famous Stanford CoNLP annotators as Spark DFM functions for text mining and natural language processing. Another one is developed by me, Spark VLBFDS. It provides a very scalable logistic regression and linear regression algorithms, which can handle more than 1 billion features in a pure Spark environment without involve any other supports, such as parameter server. So you can search the two packages, can find whether it is suitable in your use case. And another important feature is we just this feature will release, and actually it has released in our HTTP 2.6. We move to the best model, and a lot of data scientists usually will try thousands of models with different Spark versions, different Python versions, or different R versions. Python and R are the most frequently used language for data scientists. A large Python Spark application usually have many dependencies, and it's highly possible that you want to run different versions. For example, you can say data scientist A will work on a Python Spark application which depends on Spark 2.7, and data scientist B will depends on the Python 3.5. We need to provide isolated runtime environment for Python. And this is the virtual environment support for Python Spark. If you know the Python, actually it has support in the single node Python application. And we have make it support for Python Spark and Spark R in the just released HTTP 2.6. And this will make the transition from local environment to the distributed Python Spark environment very, very smoothly. Okay, after we talk about the work of data scientists, they finish their work. And the software engineer will take over the models. In traditional way, software engineer will re-implement the pipeline with Java or Scala in production, deploy the pipeline model and serving. However, re-implementing the pipeline is duplicated work and is usually error-prone. So Spark ML Lab provides pipeline and model persistence cross language clusters. You can see that data scientists save the model to a file system or a cloud data store, a cloud storage, then software can directly load with just one line of code and using them. So they don't need to re-implement any pipeline. They just need to use one line to load it. This will accelerate the process of putting the data scientist generated text mining model into production. Okay, so far data scientists and software engineer can start their work, but that is good enough. I think if you have done some hands-on text mining work on big data, you may say no, since there are very, very obvious obstacles on the way to the better model. For example, data scientists will more prefer Python or R, but software engineers maybe more use Java or Scala. How to manage or organize these calls with different kinds of languages, which may also depends on different kinds of libraries. And another very important feature is visualization. Visualization will be more intuitive to help data scientists to understand the training data and understand the model. And it usually brings inspiration for to produce better models. Could we have some utilities for visualization that will help the data scientist to tune in that model? And another very more common requirements is Test mining is also not one person's work. It's in your companies, may a lot of users will involve this project. So we need to treat it as a platform and make the data scientists to use the platform with high efficiency. And another very promising feature is whether data scientists can share their code snippets with others and collaborate with others to work together to make the model better and better. So these are some requirements, and we need to handle them. If we can get them resolved, we can get our model training process more efficiently. So that is one of the candidate answers to these questions. It's a web-based notebook, and it can enable interactive data science. We will not talk the detail of Zeppelin. We just talk about how it can help us to do text line mining. And data scientists can write Scala, or Python, or R code in the notebook, and they can use the visualization output during the interactive analysis. And they can also share their code with others. We can come back to these examples. We show how it happened when it encountered Zeppelin. With Zeppelin, Spark ML pipeline is more modular. You can see this. This is the notebook of the Zeppelin. You can clearly understand what each stage do. I'll inspect the input of each stage by just click the running button. It's here, the running button. You can get the output of each stage, and to inspect the output is right or not. Another benefit is during the construction of text mining pipeline, you may involve data exploration. For example, in the text classification example, you may want to know the number of positive or negative labels before training models. For example, you can see this is the example in our demo. In the demo just that we mentioned, we have four class. Since if the labels of the classification is skewed, or having more training examples for one label, or one class, or one category than another, which will cause the decision boundary to be biased. This will cause the classifier to prefer one class over another. So this will also lead to the incorrect result. We should check whether the model is balanced before fitting the model. So if the data is skewed, we usually simple from the data, simple some data from the group who has more elements. From this picture, we can get our training data size is perfect. So it's not skewed. The visualization output gives us a very intuitive feeling of whether the data is skewed. We can also switch between different types of visualizations. You can see commonly is shown by pie graph. But if there are more than 10 categories, the pie graph may be not so intuitive to tell you whether the data is skewed. We can switch to the to other kinds of graphs, such as the bar graph. You can just click the button here, and then they can switch to the bar graph. So this is also very important features for the data scientist to help us to make the work more efficiently. And another very useful function for Zeppelin is sharing your notebook with your collaborator to get others' opinion about your pipeline and your parameter setting. So you can hear data scientist A click the export button and save the notebook to a file system or a cloud storage. And data scientist B can load the notebook from another web browser. All this happens in web browser. And data scientist B can easily rerun the notebook and to help to tune the parameters. So this is the whole pipeline of the Tasmanian workload on big data and how it work together with data scientists and software engineer, and how Spark can handle this workload. So we have this big picture. If you have encountered some Tasmanian problems, you can refer whether this architecture or this workflow is useful for you. Okay, this is what I'm going to talk about today. Okay, any questions?